Behavioural Economics, The Basics, by Philip Corr and Anke Plagnol, read by Richard Lyddon. Preface. Behavioural economics is a relatively new and exciting branch of the social sciences, with considerable real-world applications. It is important, but it can be complex and even confusing. In recognition of this fact, this book aims to provide an introduction to the basic issues that define the field, including theoretical, historical, and practical aspects. We show that although behavioral economics may well be seen as a new branch of the social sciences, its roots go very deep in economic theory and history, all the way back to the first economist in the modern sense, Adam Smith. In fact, behavioral economics is the modern form of much older traditions and the most recent manifestation of long-standing dissatisfaction with mainstream economic viewpoints. In planning this book, we decided to do something different to other books on behavioral economics. Our book is aimed at the interested reader who wants to get a real and academically credible appreciation of this complex field, while at the same time gaining a sense of the deeper issues of economics and psychology. It is suitable for students as it is for the interested general reader. It should also be a good starting point for the professional who wants to apply behavioral economics to their own field. As we show, the applications are numerous and highly significant. Although our book is concerned with basics, it is not basic in content and discussion. We aim to provide readers with a sufficiently detailed yet accessible introduction to the whole field of behavioral economics. This is no easy feat to achieve, and we attempt to do this in a lively fashion to stimulate, perhaps even to provoke. Still, the reader has the right to ask, how does this book differ from others in this field? First, most behavioral economics books aimed at students are rich in mathematics and technical terms and are largely inaccessible to the non-economist. Ours is not. Second, our book differs from the more popular ones in being more systematic in the presentation of material. In particular, we include a discussion of the history of economics and some moral philosophy and politics, to let the reader achieve a better grasp of the larger intellectual landscape. We present the big picture, with the intention of giving a bird's-eye view of the entire subject. We especially avoid mathematics, and we do our best to explain the technical terms which must be included if we are to do anything approaching justice to the field. Students who wish to consult the primary sources of the many studies that are summarized in this book can refer to the bibliography at the end of the print edition. Most of the classic theories and concepts mentioned, including utility functions and opportunity costs, economics, social influence and priming, psychology, are covered in textbooks such as Microeconomics and Behavior by Robert Frank and Edward Cartwright, or An Introduction to Social Psychology by Houston, Schreber and Jonas. We refer the interested listener who wishes to gain a deeper or more technical understanding of these concepts to these sources. Students of economics and psychology might already be familiar with these concepts as they are taught as part of the typical undergraduate curriculum, and we therefore focus on behavioral economics references in the bibliography. As an economist, Anke Plagnol, and psychologist, Philip Corr, we have tried to present both sides of behavioral economics. It is at the intersection of these fields where behavioral economics was born, and it is where the creative synergies are found. Further online resources may be found at this website, behavioraleconomicsbasics.net. Chapter 1. What is behavioral economics and why is it important? Introduction. What is this thing called behavioral economics, and why has it set alight the worlds of business, finance, and government? Why should you want to know about it? What does it tell us about how people form judgments and make decisions in their private and public lives? How does it help us all to understand the limitations and foibles of economic behaviour? And what does it tell us about the psychological nature of financial catastrophes that afflict our economic system? For example, the stock market crash of 1929 and the global financial collapse of 2007 and 2008. What are the implications for mainstream economics? By the end of this book, you will have answers to these and many more questions, and also, you should have your own questions to ask about the world of economics, as well as your own behavioural insights to answer them. In this introductory chapter, we hear why there is a need for behavioural economics. We will understand why two pioneers received the Nobel Memorial Prize in Economic Sciences for their contributions. Daniel Kahneman in 2002, even though he is a psychologist, and, more recently, Richard Thaler in 2017, who hails from economics. In contrast to the presumptions of mainstream economics, which we will discuss in detail in Chapter 3, also seen is just how and why we misbehave in everyday life. We learn how judgment and decision-making affecting all areas of life are made by flesh-and-blood human beings, and how apparent misbehaviour may not be so irrational after all. Once we have this foundational knowledge under our belts, we will be in a better position to put to work what we know. For example, we will find out what behavioural economics has to say about the design of effective public policy interventions, which we survey in Chapter 6. This is seen in the work of the Behavioural Insights Team, also known as the Nudge Unit, which informs UK government public policy intervention and has been recognised by the US government. As the former US President Barack Obama said in 2015, "A growing body of evidence demonstrates that behavioural science insights, research findings from fields such as behavioural economics and psychology about how people make decisions and act on them, can be used to design government policies to better serve the American people." We will hear how the applications of behavioural insights have informed the commercial and even political world, surveyed in Chapter 7. These have an important impact upon our daily life. Few of us are left untouched by them. Although in the past there was much reliance on folklore and faddish psychological speculation, commercial applications are increasingly turning to hard scientific evidence in an attempt to influence us, often in ways of which we are totally unaware. Importantly, we will see that behavioural economics really is about the world in which we live and not an ivory tower academic discipline accessible only to the initiated few and intellectually nerdy. In this way, knowledge of behavioural economics is a liberating force by putting back some of the power in the hands of the people. In consequence, we might be better able to defend against the darker applications of this new psychological technology. Although this is a basics book intended for the newcomer to behavioural economics, it is not a watered-down account of the subject. It is intended to be a clear and informative account, even a lively one. Although the listener will need to delve deeper into the subject to learn more of the details, the content of this book is sufficiently detailed to provide a good overview of the foundational knowledge that defines the entire field. Of course, it cannot be exhaustive, but it needs to be adequate. In particular, we believe it should provide a good feel for the subject, which must include discussion of contentious issues. We have not shied away from them. What is behavioural economics? Let us get straight down to business. At its most general level, behavioural economics uses insights from the social sciences, for example, sociology in general and psychology in particular, to inform economic thinking and theorising. It takes knowledge from judgement and decision-making research to inform realistic assumptions about how people think, feel and act. Social psychology plays a large part too. It makes predictions that can be tested either in the laboratory where controlled studies with experimental manipulations are possible, or in the field, where either observational or experimental studies are conducted. Field experiments are popular where experimental research is conducted in a real-life context. For example, researchers may observe farming communities to examine the factors underlying cooperative behaviour. Increasingly, behavioural economics research is incorporating knowledge gained from neuroscience, the direct study of the brain in relation to psychological processes. In these ways, behavioural economics shares much in common with experimental economics, which also uses empirical, for example, experimental methods, to test theories, but not necessarily ones that contain behavioural aspects derived from psychology and related academic disciplines. A more cynical view is that behavioural economics is just repackaged psychology couched in terms to be amenable to economists and to impress those in business and government who hold economics, but not psychology, in high regard. There is some truth in this claim. We might argue about the best label or terminology for this relatively new field, but its main aim is clear. Behavioural economics strives to provide a scientific account of real economic behaviour. It develops theories, generates hypotheses, makes predictions, and tests them against the world of actual decision-making. It is less reliant than mainstream economics on a small number of foundational assumptions, axioms, upon which theories and their predictions are based. To achieve its scientific aims, behavioural economics uses the latest knowledge from the social sciences. It is not static and is continually in development. As such, it is something of a moving target and, therefore, neither easy to define nor understand. In addition, there is something else we need to know. Behavioural economics reflects the work of psychologists as well as economists. This poses something of a problem when we talk about behavioural economics, because often we are talking about the extension of psychological ideas. Many mainstream economists claim that such ideas have little to do with real economics. Nonetheless, psychologists have made major contributions to economics. And it is not only psychologists who are upsetting the apple cart of mainstream economics. Many behavioural economists come from mainstream economics background. For example, George Lowenstein and Richard Thaler. And they are far from satisfied with the standard assumptions and models. They apply insights from behavioural science to improve economics on its own terms. As we shall hear, some behavioural economists, for example Dan Ariely, are psychologists who are less wedded to the belief that central economics principles need to be retained, if only to be improved. Whatever our perspective, behavioural economics was wrought into existence by the increasing weight of evidence of strange observations, anomalies, and odd facts that the mainstream economic approach struggled to explain or even comprehend. These aberrant observations, misbehaviours, can be seen in the everyday observation of people and, if we care to look closely enough, in ourselves. They show that we often do not follow through with our best intentions. New Year's resolutions are one annual example. They are now something of a ritualized illustration of the failure of willpower. And even when we appear to have a definite preference for something, for example, saving for retirement, we do not always act in a way that maximizes the desired outcome. We procrastinate, misjudge probabilities, for example, think we may not live to enjoy the benefits, and fall prey to a number of biases that illustrate our inability to conform to the image of the idealized rational economic agent. We'll define this later on in Chapter 3. We often live for today, so often it seems that tomorrow's another day. Sometimes we just seem to do things all wrong, and importantly, systematically so. Now, none of this is especially newsworthy, but it does perplex mainstream economists and strains the credibility of standard economic models. Getting a proper grasp on behavioural economics is not helped by the fact that there is not one official account of it, nor even one that the majority of behavioural economists would readily accept. Our account is only one possible version. In its defence, it does contain most of the elements that make up other accounts. In any event, one of the best summaries of the history of behavioural economics is provided by Colin Camara and George Lowenstein, 2003, who are two of the leading lights and advocates in behavioural economics. In their paper, Behavioural Economics, Past, Present, Future, they trace the problems encountered by mainstream economics and the solutions that come from more psychologically realistic thinking. On closer scrutiny, what is especially interesting is that many of the ideas that fall under the rubric behavioural economics are themselves old, but too often they have been forgotten. Our account tries to uncover these deeper roots, and for this reason, Chapter 2 spends some time on the history of economics and long-standing criticism of the mainstream approach. We appreciate that some people may think this unnecessary, but we do not. What behavioural economics has achieved is to give scientific and professional respectability to these criticisms. More importantly, it offers alternative accounts of a wider range of behaviours, including those that are prone to baffle the mainstream economist, who expects people to behave in a consistent, rational, and optimising fashion, notions that we explore as we travel through the pages of this book. Econ or human. But for now, to begin to understand the different conceptions of mainstream and behavioural economics, it is convenient to contrast the depictions of econ, or homo economicus, and human, or homo psychologicus. Both are concerned with the fundamental problem in economics, how to allocate scarce resources to maximise some benefit, called utility in economics. This can be of anything in life, for example, where to live, who to marry, or where to invest. Econ and human. These are depictions, some would say caricatures, of the two types of mind thought to be important in behavioural economics. Mainstream economics emphasises econ, homo economicus, the cold, rational, calculating, self-interested. Psychology focuses on human, homo psychologicus, the flesh and blood being who is limited in processing capacity and prone to a number of biases, errors and influences, and who is emotionally warm and sometimes hot in how he or she makes decisions. Human is more Homer Simpson than Mr. Spock-like homo economicus. Behavioural economics is about how people actually behave. This is called descriptive or positive economics. That is, it is about flesh and blood humans who often do not seem to know what they want or how to get things done in the most logical way. The other, more mainstream, economics perspective focuses on how people should behave, called normative economics. These economic agents conform to something approximating a perfectly rational model. The fact that few people are perfect need not concern us, so long as we assume that they aspire to this state and try to achieve it to the best of their often limited ability. In its purest form, econ makes rational decisions that conform to logic, is self-interested, and finally weighs costs against benefits in order to maximise benefit. Unlike the wayward human, econ is analytical, intelligent, disinterested, and not influenced by states of the body, mood, emotion, and the like. According to some behavioural economists' way of thinking, econ is little more than a figment of mainstream economics, and a theoretically misleading one at that, even possibly a dangerous one. For example, as seen in the 2007-2008 financial crash. As Richard Thaler stated in an interview in The Psychologist in 2017, I believe that for the last 50 or 60 years, economists have devoted themselves to studying fictional creatures. They may as well be studying unicorns. At this point, you may well ask, if we know that humans are not really like econ, then why does this concept still have such a strong foothold in mainstream economics? This is a good question, but it is easier to ask than answer. One possible reason is that science often works by holding simplifying assumptions, reducing the complexity of the manifest world by creating constructs of a more abstract and latent, i.e. hidden nature. If this set of constructs can be used to understand the complex world, then something important has been achieved. This scientific model can then be used to predict, forecast new phenomena in other contexts. But there is perhaps another, more human reason. During the 20th century, mainstream economics increasingly adopted a mathematically inspired conception of the world. In this, certain assumptions had to be made in order for the equations to be tractable, that is, elegant and workable. This permitted formal theorizing expressed with the machinery of mathematics. Mathematical notation charmed and impressed the profession, and intimidated those who challenged its tenets and worldview. Such mathematics is the way economic theory is conceptualized and constructed. It is how economists think about economic problems. Mathematical prowess is also something of a badge of respectability in the economics profession and serves an important career-enhancing function. Well, knowing this, the big question remains. Does econ exist in some form? Does the idealized depiction of the rational economic agent predict the way things work in the real world? If econ does exist, and we should be careful not to dismiss it too readily, then there really would be little need for behavioral economics. It could be assigned to the conscientious study of psychological trivia with no real-world applications. To the extent that mainstream economics accepts the existence of human, it assumes that it aspires to being an econ in all important respects, especially when the stakes are high and important decisions are being made. It must also assume that human manages a good enough approximation to econ to make mainstream economic models work. But if econ does not exist in a pure form, then at what stage does it segue into human? Some behavioral economists, from both a psychology, for example Daniel Kahneman, and economics, for example George Lowenstein, background, believe that the econ model is simply unrealistic, containing an imaginary, fictional creature only to be found between the dust covers of an economics textbook where typical forms of human thinking, feeling, and behaving are largely ignored, and when not ignored, disparaged as irrational. Although caricatures, these depictions highlight the salient features of each approach. But we need to be warned that the human-econ distinction is prone to lead to a certain level of confusion. For example, it encourages binary thinking, econ or human. This may conceal the similarities between them. It is possible that people move between these two different modes, and these simple depictions do not do justice to the true variety of behavior. In addition, the human depiction is more concerned with descriptive and positive aspects, not what ought to be, but what is, as first expressed by David Hume, 1711 to 1776, who formulated the idea that you cannot deduce ought from is, in his most important work, A Treatise of Human Nature, published in 1738. Hume meant that what we choose to do with knowledge is different from the way things are. Think of cancer is and what we ought to do about it, i.e. oppose and destroy it, not support it because it follows a natural law of cell proliferation. One of the problems of understanding behavioral economics is to keep these two perspectives in mind at the same time, because both have their own merit. In fact, it is a little too easy to be critical of the assumptions of mainstream economics and to get carried away with all the excitement and the weird and wonderful things to be found in the world of behavioural economics. In this book, we do our best to eschew this temptation. We attempt to show that not all apparent examples of misbehaving are opposed to the econ model. On closer inspection, they may well be more rational than they might appear. Misbehaving. We really do not have to look too far for examples of how, in everyday life, people seem to deviate from the cherished assumptions of mainstream economics, rationality, logical decision-making, and so on. These are defined in Chapter 3. Whether these misbehaviours are noise in an otherwise rational, logical system and everything turns out econ in the end is an open question. In any event, some behavioural economists think such deviations are normal, the stuff of everyday life, even when making important decisions. For example, Richard Thaler, in his 2015 book of the same name, believes that behavioural economics is all about misbehaving, an expression we have employed previously, by which he means how human economic agents deviate from econ model predictions. I mean that their behaviour was inconsistent with the idealised model of behaviour that is at the heart of what we call economic theory, said Thaler. Trained in economics, Thaler spent much of his early career cataloguing such misbehaviours, what he calls supposedly irrelevant factors, or SIFs, which turn out to be very relevant in practice. As Thaler says in 2015, "For 4 decades since my time as a graduate student, I've always been preoccupied by these kinds of stories about the myriad ways in which people depart from the fictional creatures that populate economic models." He lists many forms of misbehaving in his lively book, which recounts his journey from ignored economist, who seemed interested only in the trivia of behaviour, to professional respectability as 2015 President of the American Economic Association and 2017 Nobel Prize winner. He characterises his early days as responding to one-line put-downs from economists who had their own way of doing things. As we might readily guess, the fact that we so often misbehave should not come as much of a surprise. Consider one of the central assumptions of economic theory. People make choices by optimizing. That is, they are said to make the best choices based on what is available and what they can afford. Choices are subject to their budget constraints, to you and I, what we can afford. This is fair enough. But, as Thaler notes in his 2015 book, there is, however, a problem. The premises on which economic theory rests are flawed. First, optimization problems that ordinary people confront are often too hard for them to solve or even come close to solving. Thaler goes on to say, second, the beliefs upon which people make their choices are not unbiased. Overconfidence may not be in the economist's dictionary, but it is a well-established feature of human nature, and there are countless other biases that have been documented by psychologists. Thaler then notes an additional issue that reflects the complexity of actual economic life. Third, there are many factors that the optimization model leaves out. There is a long list of things that are supposedly irrelevant. Thaler gives many examples of misbehaving and the influence of SIFs. Let us consider one SIF, a student essay marked out of a total 100 or 137 marks. Thaler found that his students would often grumble if they received a 72 out of 100 possible marks, but they would be quite content to receive 96 out of a possible 137. These were economics students who are otherwise thought to be rational. Which mark would you prefer? In the second case, students are getting 70%, which is lower than the 72% in the first case. There are several biases here. 96 is bigger than 72. It is easy to see that 72 out of 100 is 72%, but what about 96 out of 137? Many of us would need a calculator. You can probably think of other things going on too. From a strictly rational point of view, this is all nonsense, misbehaving, as 72% is always better than 70%, but it is not the way the students see things. In an important way, behavioural economics is characterised by taking seriously these SIFs, factors that should not matter, but actually do. This can be very annoying because it makes the world of mainstream economics, which contains simple assumptions and elegant mathematical models, very messy. Whether the payoff in terms of realistic theorising and prediction is a price worth paying for disrupting this internally consistent worldview of economics is a moot point. Behavioural economists think it is. Supposedly irrelevant factors, or SIFs. Saving £10. Suppose David is shopping for a clock radio. He finds a model he likes, and his search is uncovered that it is available for £45 in a local shop. As David is about to buy it, the sales assistant lets slip that that same clock radio can be bought at their new store, a 10-minute drive away, for a special offer price of £35. We assume the cost of the additional travel is minor. Do you think David will drive to the new store for this bargain? Would you? On another occasion, David is shopping for a flat-screen TV and has found one at a good price of £495 at the same local store. As luck would have it, when he is about to buy it, the sales assistant once again lets slip that he can buy the same TV for £485 at another of their newly opened stores, which is also a 10-minute drive away. What does David do in this case? And is it different to his decision with the clock radio? When posed with these choices, many people say they would drive to the new store to save £10 on the clock radio, but they would not drive there to save the same amount of money on the TV. From a mainstream economic perspective, this is indeed strange behaviour, because an identical, absolute saving is made in both cases, £10. What seems to be influencing these different decisions is the percentage of the total price that can be saved by driving to the other store. But this is a SIF, and it should not influence David's buying decision. Tversky and Kahneman asked their participants similar questions about calculators in 1981. Throughout this book, we see many examples of well-established misbehaviours, which characterise how typical humans come to judgments and make decisions. In the example coming up, we'll hear of one well-known puzzle that has most people scratching their heads and then kicking themselves for being so silly when they learn of the right solution. Thaler goes on to make a good point about how we should interpret the foibles of everyday human judgment and decision-making. It has never been my point to say that there is something wrong with people. We're all just human beings, Homo sapiens. Rather, the problem is with the model used by economists. This statement comes from an economist steeped in mainstream economic thinking who has reached the top of his profession and who is regularly consulted by national governments, for example, the UK government nudge unit. The abstract econ, which is at the core of mainstream economic models, is apparently a very poor substitute for real humans. Misbehaving, bat and ball problem. Think about this seemingly simple calculation. A bat and a ball cost £1.10 in total. The bat costs £1 more than the ball. How much does the ball cost? What is your answer? Most people are confident that the ball must cost 10 pence. This feels like the right answer, but it is not. Think about it this way. If the ball costs 10 pence, and the bat costs £1 more than the ball, then the bat would cost £1.10, giving a total of £1.20. The correct answer is that the ball costs 5 pence, and the bat costs, at a pound more, £1.05, giving a total of £1.10. This is an example of how we typically replace a difficult problem with a simpler one. One explanation of this puzzle is that we seem to non-consciously substitute the more than statement in the problem, i.e. the bat costs £1 more than the ball, with an absolute statement, the bat costs £1. This puzzle can be found in Kahneman 2011 and other sources. Behavioural economics, supplant or supplement? At this point in our discussion, it is appropriate to inquire about the ultimate aim of behavioural economics. One view is that it is a natural development of mainstream economics which it merely aims to improve. As Kammerer and Lowenstein, 2003, state, behavioural economics increases the explanatory power of economics by providing it with more realistic psychological foundations. They also state that their belief in the power of realistic psychological models does not imply a wholesale rejection of the neoclassical approach. In the following chapters, we will discuss neoclassical economics, which, for the time being, we are calling mainstream economics. However, other notable behavioral economists are less optimistic in this respect. For example, Dan Ariely, in his highly popular 2008 book, Predictably Irrational, says in relation to trying to convince mainstream economists of the importance of what he calls irrational behavior, "Of course, I ran into the biggest difficulties when arguing for irrationality with card-carrying rational economists, whose disregard of my experimental data was almost as intense as their nearly religious belief in rationality. If Adam Smith's invisible hand doesn't sound like God, I don't know what does." Adam Smith's ideas are discussed later on in Chapter 2. As Ariely was not trained in economics, he is a psychologist and behavioural scientist, along with people like Daniel Kahneman, he is less sympathetic to the general aims of mainstream economics than those coming from this intellectual tradition. Ariely further says, "I have been acutely aware that humans engage in actions and make decisions that are often divorced from rationality and sometimes very far from ideal. Over the years, I've tried to understand the silly, dumb, amusing, and sometimes dangerous mistakes we all make, in the hope that by understanding our irrational quirks, we can retrain ourselves to make better decisions." It would be fair to say that mainstream economists have not taken these criticisms entirely with a sense of equanimity. They retort that findings from artificial and contrived laboratory studies, often based on small samples of psychology students, may not generalize to the real, competitive world, the market, where participants are truly incentivized and motivated to behave as rationally as possible. "Surely," they say, "people would be fools not to behave as rationally and self-optimizing as possible, especially when it really matters." The assumption is that, when truly put to the test, human quickly becomes econ. People behave rationally when motivated to do so, for example, choosing a mortgage or marriage partner. Economists of this more traditional mindset also probably have little time for anecdotes of the kind favoured by Dan Ariely and Richard Thaler about their personal observations of the foibles of others. Instead, they prefer axiomatic assumptions and what they believe to be tried and tested principles. Still, other, some very notable, economists are pragmatic about the whole business. As the leading economist Larry Summers, former Secretary of the US Treasury and past President of Harvard, said, "And if you are worldly and empirical, you are drawn to behavioural approaches," as quoted in Harvard magazine Lambert 2006. However, mainstream economists' belief in the inherent rationality of humans is sometimes put to the test, not by small-scale, student-focused lab studies, but by global events that profoundly shock economies around the world. The 2007-2008 global financial crash. Few events are more likely to focus the minds of economists and the general public than the loss of many billions of pounds and dollars. The 2007-08 global financial crash marked an important turning point in the recognition and increasing acceptance of behavioral economics. It also reminded economists of Karl Marx's prediction that the capitalistic system was not only prone to periodic crises, but to eventual collapse due to its internal contradictions. Before this crash, few mainstream economists harboured this Marxian dread. But after it, there was more reason to reflect upon it. The unpredictability of the 2007-2008 crash came as much as a surprise to them as to non-experts. Only Marxists could take joy in their "we told you so." Indeed, as Thaler in 2015 highlighted, virtually no economist saw the financial crisis of 2007-2008 coming, and worse, many thought that both the crash and its aftermath were things that simply could not happen. One exception was Robert Shiller, who went on to win the Nobel Prize for Economic Sciences in 2013. Shiller warned in his 2000 book, Irrational Exuberance, that the stock market had already, by 2000, become a bubble and was bound to burst at some point. During the inflation of such a bubble, jumping on the speculative bandwagon is not, of course, irrational, but the trick is to know when to jump off before it bursts. Shiller's academic work challenged the efficient market hypothesis, which assumes that stock market investors base stock prices on the expected future dividends discounted to present value. Analysis of data going back to the 19th century convinced Shiller that this theory simply cannot explain the large variation seen in stock market prices. In other words, prices fluctuate, often wildly, for reasons other than a rational valuation of companies. His subsequent work also confirmed that traders are influenced by their emotions and not a rational calculation of the market. The policy decisions of economists such as Alan Greenspan, chairman of the Federal Reserve of the United States between 1987 and 2006, contributed to the 2007-08 financial crash. In what must be one of the most honest admissions of all time, Greenspan said before the Congressional Committee on October 23, 2008, "Those of us who have looked to the self-interest of lending institutions to protect shareholders' equity, myself especially, are in a state of shocked disbelief." And, referring to his free market ideology, Greenspan said, "I have found a flaw. I don't know how significant or permanent it is, but I've been very distressed by that fact." Pressed by the representative Henry Waxman, who asked Greenspan, "In other words, you found that your view of the world, your ideology, was not right. It was not working." Greenspan replied candidly, "Absolutely, precisely. You know, that's precisely the reason I was shocked, because I've been going for 40 years or more with very considerable evidence that it was working exceptionally well." Clark and Trainer, 2008. Greenspan's disbelief in what happened seems to have been conditioned by his adherence to the philosophy of free markets and personal responsibility. Dan Ariely, in 2008, recorded the views of the New York Times columnist David Brooks that Greenspan's congressional confession amounted to a coming-out party for behavioral economists and others who are bringing sophisticated psychology to the realm of public policy. At least these folks have plausible explanations for why so many people could have been so gigantically wrong about the risks they were taking. The 2007 to 2008 time period was, indeed, critical for the world economy and crucial for behavioral economics. Something clearly was wrong with the mainstream economic worldview, and the 2007-08 financial crisis was not the first of its kind. For example, the US stock market crash of 1929 and the Deep Depression of the early 1930s. Alas, it is unlikely to be the last. History has a habit of making fools of those who claim it can't happen again. This was seen with another notable economist, Ben Bernanke, former chairman of the Central Reserve, the Central Bank of the USA, and chairman of President George W. Bush's Council of Economic Advisers, who espoused the theory of the Great Moderation, which stated that traditional business cycles are less volatile and the economic world is a more stable place. For example, Bernanke 2004. Like many others, this theory had good cause to be revised after 2008. Such is the appeal, or shock, of the 2007-08 financial crash. Popular films have chronicled it, for example, Margin Call in 2011. In 2015, The Big Short did a superb job of explaining how highly complex financial derivatives based on bundles of mortgages obscured the fragility of the market, especially as many of the mortgages were high-risk subprime. Richard Thaler has a cameo role in the film. Appropriately, the film opens with an apt, if misattributed to Mark Twain, quote, "It ain't what you don't know that gets you into trouble, it's what you know for sure that just ain't so." History repeats itself. History is not, now, typically taught in university economics courses, which is to be regretted because it contains lessons for us all. Irving Fisher, 1867 to 1947, was one of the foremost mainstream economists of his day, but history played a cruel trick on him because he is now better remembered for one of the biggest predictive failures of all time. He confidently pronounced a permanently high plateau in the US stock market, but not long afterwards it suffered a major crash in 1929 and ushered in the Great Depression of the 1930s. Fisher's family misfortune provided an instructive lesson of the power of reality over presumption. Rival forecaster Roger Babson wryly observed that Fisher thinks the world is ruled by figures instead of feelings, as quoted in Harvard 2014. Throughout this book, we will hear the power of feelings, emotion, and the like in economic judgment, decision-making, and behavior. As the examples we've just mentioned attest, history has no respect for reputation or status. Indeed, it so often shows disdain. As an example, reflecting the collective wisdom of his economic advisers, the then UK Chancellor of the Exchequer, Gordon Brown, was fond to assert during his 10-year stint at the Treasury that the British economy of the future must be built not on the shifting sands of boom and bust, but on the bedrock of prudent and wise economic management for the long term, as quoted in Summers 2008. Since 2008, we are still recovering from this prudent management. We might well think that the fable of King Canute should be in the minds of those who have a fondness for fortune-telling, especially in economic matters. J.K. Galbraith cruelly joked, economic forecasting was invented to make astrology look respectable. Jokes aside, critics of mainstream economics continue to point to its inability to predict and explain financial crashes. They also accuse their opponents of being in denial of the magnitude of their predictive failures. This even comes from true insiders. Mervyn King, former governor of the Bank of England, and a foremost academic economist who has been at the heart of central government policymaking for many years, makes this clear in his 2016 book, The End of Alchemy: Banking, the Global Economy, and the Future of Money. His argument is that economic decisions always occur under conditions of what he calls radical uncertainty, that is, ignorance about the future. This cannot be remedied by the quantification of probabilities and, as such, optimizing behavior is not possible. To deal with this uncertain state, King contends that people use narratives to make sense of the world. In the felicitous phrase of J.K. Galbraith, we are much reassured by the conventional wisdom, i.e. strongly held beliefs that have, at best, a tenuous grounding in reality, Galbraith, 1958. King believes that mainstream economics misunderstood the world before the 2007-2008 financial crisis, and, most worryingly, it has not learnt its lesson since. King makes another good point. History is what happened before you were born. That is why it is so hard to learn lessons from history. The mistakes were made by the previous generation. Surely we might think we would not be as stupid as them. As an example of the fallout from the 2007-08 financial crash, especially regarding the perceived inadequacies of mainstream economics, some students of economics have been in revolt, demanding a change to the standard curriculum. The narrow and uncritical focus of mainstream economics is addressed in the student-led 2016 book by Earl Moran and Ward Perkins, The Econocracy, The Perils of Leaving Economics to the Experts. They note that students can, and often do, go through 3 years of a university economics degree course without ever being asked to write an essay, let alone a critical one, of the discipline. Critics of mainstream economics have been assisted by the establishment of new professional bodies, which challenge mainstream orthodoxy and encourage what they see as more enlightened forms of economic thinking. For example, in the UK, the New Economics Foundation, and in the USA, the Institute for New Economic Thinking. In all of this, the major challenge faced by behavioural economics is to make economic models more psychologically realistic without sacrificing the parsimony and wide-ranging applications enjoyed by the mainstream approach. This is no small challenge. It is often more comforting to stick with the tried and failed than the new and unknown, perhaps an example of misbehaving. Money, money, money. To understand mainstream and behavioural economics a little better, it is worth thinking about the notion of money. It may not be a notion when in your purse or wallet, but it is in economic theory. The pop group ABBA had a smash hit in 1976 with Money, 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 in which they sang about money being funny. They were right, but in economics, not quite in the way they meant. As noted by Mervyn King in his 2016 book, money often seems to be the main focus of economics, and, somewhat surprisingly to the non-economist, there is no consensus as to what it is and how it is created. Strange, perhaps, but true. There is something else about money that we need to appreciate in relation to behavioural economics. In fact, as we'll discuss in a moment and elsewhere in this book, money can confuse what we mean by self-interested behaviour and rationality. Evidence is given throughout this book. Mention of economics in the fashion or lifestyle sections of the national press is rarely seen. It is to be found in the money, business, or financial pages. This tells us something important, namely the central role assigned to money. It is so obvious we rarely have cause to think about it, although we think all the time how to get and spend it. Indeed, it can seem that economics is interested in little else, but this is untrue. For a start, we may give away money in an apparently unselfish act, but in return, we derive psychological benefit, value, or utility. Couching economic behaviour purely in terms of money is unhelpful at best and misleading at worst. We explore this issue throughout this book. ABBA were right. Money is a funny thing. Money has a psychological dimension. It conveys meaning and interpersonal value. Mainstream economics tells us that values we attach to all things in life can be expressed in monetary form. This is reflected in the willingness to pay concept, which is sometimes used in economic research. Willingness to pay reflects the maximum amount of money someone is willing to give up to obtain a good or service or to avoid a bad outcome. It can be used to evaluate outcomes that are inherently non-monetary, for example, the health benefits resulting from healthcare programs. The idea that goods and bads can be measured in monetary terms makes it possible to compare the satisfaction, happiness, or whatever, i.e. value, utility of one thing with another. It is for this reason that economics is so focused on money. It really is the common currency of everyday life. Therefore, money can be used as a convenient metric to measure what often seem intangible things vis-a-vis other goods and services we might want to consume. Behavioural economics is very much about such apparent intangibles. For example, cooperation and the subjective utility we get from helping other people. What this discussion suggests is that once we move away from a strictly money-based interpretation of value or utility, we enter into the social realm populated by behavioural ideas. And while this realm is not necessarily antithetical to mainstream economics, it is far more tolerant of alternative perspectives. Indeed, as we hear in the next section, focus on money can seriously confuse matters, even for behavioural economists. One day at a time. New York City taxi drivers. One of the most vivid field studies in behavioural economics focused on the working patterns of taxi drivers in New York City. Reported by Camera, Babcock, Lowenstein and Thaler in 1997, this study found that taxi drivers, especially inexperienced ones, tended to set themselves a daily target and then stopped work once this target had been met. This occurred irrespective of the hourly earnings potential, which varied day by day depending on weather conditions. Taxi driving is ideal for such a study because drivers decide their own working hours. Typically, they hire their taxis for 12 hours per day. This study raises many issues of relevance to economics, and for us is a convenient way to think about the assumptions and principles discussed throughout this book. This field study is notable for several reasons. First, the findings contradict one major mainstream economic theory of labour supply called the life cycle model, for example, Lucas and Rapping, 1969. The life cycle part of the theory relates to the fact that people should allocate their labour resources, i.e. time spent working, efficiently over time, weeks, months, years, and even lifetime, and not based on just one day at a time. Central to the model is the notion that people should work more when wages are high and consume more leisure time when its price, i.e. the foregone wage, is low. What this means is that taxi drivers should spend more time working when business is good, i.e. on rainy days, and they should take it easy on bad business days, i.e. when the sun is out and people want to stretch their legs and are less likely.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.